Welcome, friends. My name is Dan Yoon, and I am joined by Annie Rose, who is our National Director of Ministerial Health. And today we continue another one of our webinars in our current series called Kingdoms and Identities. Now, this webinar series has really been for our EPC denomination as we march towards Election Day, but not just regarding the election, but this is really about how we as the people of God, as Christ followers, can show up in a way that is true to our identities as his people. And so hopefully you found our past webinars helpful for you and your congregations. Today we have the privilege to having our guest, Patrick Miller, who we'll introduce here shortly. But thanks again for joining us for tonight's episode of Kingdoms and Identities. So before we continue, I'm going to kick it over to our friend Annie to open up our time in prayer and show us a roadmap of what tonight's experience will look like.
Awesome, Dan. Thank you so much. Please join me in prayer. Lord Jesus, we confess that you are the head of the church. You are the foundation, the cornerstone. You are the one in whom all things hold together, Lord. And we are so grateful to be a part of your body. Brothers and sisters, through the gift of your Holy Spirit, called to be your people in this place and time. So we pray for your Holy Spirit's presence with us tonight. We thank you for your presence by the Spirit. We ask that you would anoint this time that we are together, thinking together, listening, so that we might grow more in your image and likeness, so that we might be more faithful reflections of your glory and your kingdom. We ask all of this in your holy name. Amen. All right, friends. Well, tonight we are very, very blessed to have Patrick Miller with us. I'm going to ask Patrick to introduce himself in just a moment, but he is an EPC teaching elder. He serves as one of the pastors at The Crossing, an EPC church in Columbia, Missouri. He's also the author of Truth Over Tribe, Pledging Allegiance to the Lamb, Not the Donkey or the Elephant. And we took the title for tonight's webinar discussion from that book as well. What else do I want to tell you? Tonight, Dan and I are going to be very blessed to have a conversation with Patrick, talking about how we can more faithfully follow Jesus through this political landscape, what the discipleship opportunities are for us in the challenging times we live in. And then we will turn to open for some Q&A from you. So if you are watching tonight and you have a burning question that you would like to ask Patrick, there'll be a time toward the end of our webinar where you can use the Q&A function at the bottom of your Zoom screen to interact with him there. So without any further ado, Patrick, thank you once again for joining us tonight. We are so grateful for, number one, your service to the Lord and his kingdom as a part of the EPC. And we're really grateful for the expertise you bring to this topic. Tell us a little bit about yourself.
Well, let's start with the most important detail. I am married. My wife's name is Emily, and I've got two kiddos, Oliver and Iris, who you may meet before the end of the night, if we're lucky, or you may hear. It's hard to tell. I am at home right now, so I apologize if there's screaming children. They're delightful until they're not, just like all kids. So they might be in here at some point. We'll see what happens. But like you said, I am a pastor, and I have a heart for churches. I have a heart for pastors, especially in this cultural moment where I do think building, maintaining, and developing institutions like churches is incredibly, incredibly challenging. And so that's my heart, you know, being here is I want to bless my fellow pastors and encourage, I hope, some of you to stay the course during this challenging time.
That's great, Patrick. We appreciate that. And I'm sure that as our conversation goes on, we'll get more insight into you, maybe your ministry, and just other things about you. So as Annie opened this up with, you wrote a book, co-authored a book called Truth Over Tribe. And you also happen to have a podcast by that same name. So I guess with that in mind, if you wouldn't mind sharing with us what it was that compelled you to write that book, what were some motivating factors? Or maybe from another angle, what kinds of needs were you seeking to address through that work?
If you're pastoring, I think you'll identify with what I'm about to say. If you go back in a time machine about 10 years ago and you were bringing people into our church and they were asking us questions about, why would I become a member? What are the things I want to know before I become a member? Those questions would have inevitably been theological. They'd want to hear our theology of predestination. They'd want to understand why we baptize infants. Those were the common questions we had from Christians. Now, if you go to, maybe 5 years ago, those questions slowly began to change. Instead, people were beginning to ask us questions about what's your position on CRT? What's your position on LGBTQ issues? And they wanted to know what our posture was towards culture. They wanted to try to pin us on this left-right dichotomy, binary, and they had a hard time with us because we didn't fit neatly into one category or another. And the real impetus behind Truth Over Tribe, the book and the podcast, came in 2019, so right before the pandemic. People think of 2020 as being this awful year, and we all forget 2019 was awful. It was actually, I remember when 2020 started, we said, hey, this is going to, whatever happens this year, it's going to be so much better than last year. How'd that turn out? But at the end of 2019, we had all the protests around George Floyd after he was murdered. And when that happened at our church, we had people message us on Facebook that Sunday, and they said, if you don't grieve the death of George Floyd in church today, we're going to leave the church. Now, here's the deal. We do not do liturgy by Facebook recommendation. However, our worship leader had already planned a moment of grieving to say, just to grieve what had happened. He didn't say anything about police officers. It was just grieving and lamenting that event. And that's in part because we have a decent sized Black population that's a part of our church. And we knew that they were grieving. And Jesus told us, mourn with those who mourn. We have a very clear command in scripture. So we were just acting on that command. Well, after the service, we get the next set of emails from the other side that said, I can't believe that we did that during service. You are dishonoring police officers. You're against police officers. Now, of course, we have plenty of police officers who are part of our congregation. We love police officers, and we said nothing about police officers. We only mourned the death of a man, right? And what that represented for the Black community, which I don't even think we got that heavily into. And it highlights that if you want to obey Jesus, you are going to take flack from both sides. In the same week, I've been called a left-wing Marxist because we preached about the topic of racism, and called a right-wing fascist because we didn't teach CRT. That's the reality of pastoring, especially in 2019 and 2020, which is when we were working on the book, when we were launching the podcast. We began to realize that polarization was shredding apart the church. And if Jesus died to tear down the dividing wall between Jew and Gentile, as Paul says in Ephesians 2, how much more so should we expect that his death tears down the dividing wall between the left and the right? We live in a very, very blue region in a red state. That meant that our congregation is incredibly politically diverse. You cannot assume that the person sitting down the aisle from you didn't vote for the other candidate. You can't go to small group and assume that the person who you're praying alongside didn't vote for the other candidate. And so this was a real live issue for us. We had to figure out, how do we disciple our people through political polarization that's happening outside of the church and guide them to put their allegiance in the right things? And that's where the title came from. We wanted to be the kinds of people who say, look, we don't pledge allegiance to the lamb. Sorry, we don't pledge allegiance to the donkey. We don't pledge allegiance to the elephant. We pledge allegiance to the lamb. And what does that actually mean in our life together? So that was the genesis of the podcast. That was the genesis of the book. And it's developed into new things over time, but our heart was to help lay level Christians release their allegiances. I am okay if you want to vote down the ticket Republican, or you want to vote down the ticket Democrat. That is fine with me. What I don't want you to be is someone who thinks that the person on the other side of the political aisle can't be a follower of Jesus, or that the person on the other side of the political aisle is either vile or stupid. I want you to be the kind of Christian who realizes that our allegiances to politics are much lower than our allegiances to God, and we hold them loosely. And if we hold them loosely, we will be much more healthy citizens in our community, in our civics.
Really good. That's really good. As you're sharing, and I've never been to your church and congregation personally, but from how you've described it, it may be a bit of a unique situation from those participating. I mean, maybe not. I mean, you described it right. Like the state is one thing, but your immediate geographical region is on the other side, if you will. And so I think your approach to elevating Jesus, right, trying to help us figure out in terms of prioritization, what affinity or under whose lordship do we really fall under, was really cool. But now that was what, almost 5 years ago. So yeah. If we were to kind of survey the last handful of years in light of your response, how would you describe your congregation at this point? Whether whether from the people that you received flack from directly, maybe they're not part of your congregation, but maybe they are. So could you give us kind of like a snapshot update on what that looks like at your church these days?
I think that the average congregation is probably going to be reflective of the average American. And there have been a number of studies that have shown that it's really the smallest margins of Americans that are extremely committed to their political party. These are people who are highly, highly political active. Maybe 6 to 7% of people who are progressive, and maybe 8 to 10% of people who are conservative. The vast majority of people fall in between that. So what is that? 80% of people. And the vast majority of that 80% is what people have called the exhausted majority, which means that the majority of people who are in your church, by the way, I'm going to add another statistic in here. We are currently at the high watermark of independence in American history. Over 50% of the American electorate currently identifies as independent. And to be clear, that's not people who say I'm independent, but in reality, I vote down the ballot with one party. These are people who answer questions like, have you voted for different candidates from different political parties in the last three elections? When you vote down the ballot, do you vote for one party or do you vote for multiple parties? You have to check those boxes to qualify as independent in these studies. Over 50% of people qualify as independent. This has never happened in American history. So it's beginning to give us a little bit of a picture here when we look at all that together, which is that we get worried because the loudest voices in our congregations are those extremes. They're always going to be the loudest. They do not represent the majority. And there was a reality, I think, for a lot of pastors, us included, we had to grow a certain level of pastoral resilience to know that when someone came along and they were really upset, it may or may not, depending on the individual, be possible to talk them down. And when we couldn't, we just had to be okay with those people moving on. The easy track, if you wanted to, grow your church rapidly, is just go hard right and say, hey, we're all in on this. And that was a church growth strategy for some people. Less easy to go hard left, although we have the rainbow flag churches in our community as well. That will attract people if you just syncretize yourself to one side or the other. But what we discovered is it's not a great church growth strategy for one reason. That's not the majority of people in our country. And so if you want to reach a majority, you need to reach people who are exhausted. You need to reach people who are independent, people who don't strongly identify with other party, people who feel very disenchanted with their political parties. And it turns out that Christianity, the good news of the gospel, that there's a different king who rules over a different kingdom, for whom the Oval Office would be a major demotion because he sits on the throne of heaven. That is fantastic news to the average person. Because whether it's Trump or Kamala, or whether it's Trump or it's Biden, whoever it is, you know what doesn't change? The guy who's sitting on the throne. And we need that kind of non-anxious presence in our communities. I think people are deeply attracted to it. I am largely convinced that the most important political act I'm going to do this year is not what I'm going to do in November. It's not going to be the ballot that I cast. It's going to be the way I live in my community and the political acts I do inside of my community to love my neighbor.
That's such a good word. That is such a good word, Patrick. Thank you. Well, as you look kind of at the landscape of the evangelical church and the way that we have and the way that we are engaging in the political process, what do you find encouraging? What seems to be the way that it should be according to the scriptures?
Yeah, maybe I'll sidestep that for 1 second, because I think it is important for us to actually step back and analyze our political landscape, understand where we're at. So I'm going to share my screen here. I just want to share this to everyone. So first, let's just evaluate. Hopefully, can you guys see that okay?
It says your screen sharing. Oh, there we go. Yep, now it's working.
Awesome. Okay. So this is from Ryan Burge, my friend Ryan Burge. He's the best sociologist of religion in the country right now. And this is looking at different denominations and saying what percentage of that denomination say they're going to vote for one candidate. And we need to be really clear here. This doesn't mean I love that candidate. It doesn't mean I'm all in on that candidate. It's saying, who are you voting for? And so part of what we need to realize is in the, at least for us, you know, the EPC is actually one of the most committed to Trump denominations in the country. So you can get a look at this here. Assemblies of God right here at the top. And then you've got the EPC right there. And so that just tells us that if you're going to look at our denomination in particular, we should expect that the majority of people are going to lean right. So it's, let's know our picture and let's have an honest picture of our picture. Now, I'm not making any evaluations on that. I'm actually pretty disinterested in this, but it does help. So let me go to something else here for a second. I'm going to share one other screen. Here we go. Okay. Hopefully that'll pop up. Is that up? All right.
Now it is.
There we go. It's just taking a second. So I want to show you something else. This is also by Ryan Burge. This is in a fascinating post he did. So let's start here. We have this picture of evangelicals as being this angsty, politically active group, and they're out there to get power because they're afraid of losing power. In fact, Tim Alberta's recent book, The Power and the Glory, I think it's called, he opens with his story of his dad being an EPC pastor in Michigan. And at his dad's funeral, people come up to him because he writes for The Atlantic and say, you know, I can't believe that you're out there saying all these public things about you're not voting for Trump and how evil it is. And he's like, this is my dad's funeral. What are you guys doing, right? So that's how his book opens up. And he goes on to make a convincing case that there certainly are evangelicals who are very syncretized to the right, who are very fearful of losing power. And that's what's motivating. And that's the case that he makes in the book. The problem with the book, and I like Tim Alberta, we've had him on the podcast, so I want a real picture, is that when you look at the data, evangelicals are not nearly as politically motivated as we often think. So first of all, there's no one more politically motivated than atheists. So we just need to start there. That's what all the stats tell us. Atheists, now, why? In lieu of religion, in lieu of a faith in the eternal God, in lieu of a reality of a future resurrection, is it any shock that we throw all of our chips in the political milieu in which we live for our short period of life, if I believe that I'm an atheist? But let's go down. Now let's look at some of these stats. So this is just saying, have you engaged in political activities in the previous month? Donating money to candidates, we'll look at putting up a political sign. Now, what I want you to catch, where my mouse is going, where they don't have EPC on here, so just look at non-denom evangelical. What you will immediately discover is that mainline denominations are far more politically active than evangelicals, far more, significantly more. So we'll just, you see it right here. There's all your mainline. You go all the way down here, you've got evangelical. See, it's a similar thing here with putting up a political sign. It's a little closer on that one. Working for a candidate. These are all in the same order, so you get the same picture. Assemblies of God, by the way, which remember was the most committed to Trump of all denominations, is also one of the least politically active denominations. So you see how these stats, all of a sudden you're getting a really nuanced picture. So let's go all the way down here. So this is just kind of, you're seeing the same stats put together. I want to get down to this bottom one. So now he's saying, hey, here's the average number of political acts in 2020. And the max is that you can have a six. Well, down here, you've got non-denominational, you've got Southern Baptist. Look at the gap that we have between the mainline churches and these down here. It's massive. And so again, I want to caution pastors because I really bought into the narrative that the evangelical right was motivated by power and they didn't want to lose power. And I think there's truth for some individuals. I'm not saying that's a false picture. What I have to face, though, is that actually our most politically motivated people right now are atheists and mainliners. That's the picture. So I think that's really fascinating, and I want to make sure they have a true picture. Here's the last thing. This is something I think is really important for us to know. Let's see if I can pull this up without losing the screen sharing. There we go. Okay, these are my private texts. I guess I should get rid of it. Anyways, I'll read them to you. Here we go. So I've got a friend. His name is Mike Graham. He wrote The Great Dechurching, which was the single largest study of dechurched individuals in the United States that's ever been conducted. We got to play a role in that. It was fantastic. If you haven't read The Great Dechurching, one of the most important books of the last year, it's an absolute must read. Turns out about 40 million Americans have dechurched in the last 25 years. It's happened in our churches, it's happening across the country. And so I asked him how much of this is being motivated by politics, especially by syncretism to the right. Because again, that's the problem that you tend to see in evangelicalism. So I already said, we're not as politically motivated as people say, but we are definitely on the right. Now, how's this affecting people in our churches? Okay, let's take last thing. of the 300,000 ex-evangelicals that they studied, this is a key reason they left the church. It is because of political syncretism. But here's where it gets really interesting. In the early 90s and 80s, when you had the moral majority thing happening, the vast majority of people turned off by the right wing were actually mainliners and Roman Catholics, not evangelicals. It's not until you get to basically the late 90s that it begins to influence a different group of people, which is actually affluent Black men. Those are the people who are most likely to de-church because of what they saw as evangelical syncretism to the right wing. It's not, and once you get into the 2000s, it's mostly lower middle class and lower educated Gen X women that are put off by the syncretization between the evangelicalism and the right. And from 2016 to now, it's mostly educated evangelical white women who are de-churching as a result of some of the syncretization. So if what you hoped here was I was going to come here and paint this beautiful, clear, crystal picture where, gosh, we know how all the pieces fit together, I'm clearly not interested in doing that. I am trying to say that there are consequences to the way in which we have been married to the right in particular. And I'm not attacking the right. So some people are going to hear that. You saw the facts. We're a denomination. We're 70X percent committed to the right. So we need to talk about it. And there are consequences in terms of de-churching. So when you ask me what's discouraging about this moment, that's part of what I would bring up. When I talk about what's encouraging, it's where I started in saying we are far less politically motivated and active than we're often painted as being. And I think that shows that there's this incredible opportunity for pastors, rather than talking down to our congregation, saying, oh, you guys, you're all motivated by politics because we got these really loud people who are angry at us because we didn't say the thing that they want. We have got to shut down those voices. I'm not saying, I'm gonna be really careful. I'm not saying unpastorally tell them to please stop talking. What I'm trying to say is in our own ears, we need to turn down the volume and realize they are not representing the majority. The majority of people are not very politically active in our churches. They might be right-leaning, but they don't feel super committed to the right. It's not a big, so if that's who I'm talking to, then what I need to do is pastor and shepherd someone, right? And we do that in really simple ways, you know? You drop facts like this. In Iran in the 1990s, there were 500 Christians in Iran. 500, that's all. Today, there's over a million Christians in Iran. Why? Well, it's because we elected the right president, right? Oh, no, I got it wrong. It wasn't that, was it? Because we got the right guy on the Supreme Court, right? That's it. That's the thing that happened. Of course, that's not it. And when we help our people see this global vision of what Christ is doing in his kingdom, he is sitting on the throne, it will really minimize what we start thinking about in terms of politics. When we help alongside Jesus say, render unto Caesar what is Caesar's and render unto God what is God's. What I have to render unto God is the image of God, myself, my whole self. And what I have to give to Caesar, he can have the dollars with his face on it. That's it. That's the kind of loose-handedness that we need to develop in our people. And again, I can get more into how we do that and what that looks like. So that's what's encouraging me is I think people are actually far less politically motivated than the media gives us a picture of, if I'm going to be totally candid. But there's still room to grow. And that would be the discouragement, which we should probably get into in just a second, which is our people are not politically discipled.
So, I appreciate your insights and, sharing other points of information that might give us a wider perspective. Because to your point, when there are very loud voices from two seemingly extreme ends of a spectrum, it kind of like drowns out the ability to think clearly. So I think Annie originally asked about what was encouraging, and you kind of gave us a twofer to share both what you thought was encouraging and discouraging. But as I'm listening to you, it almost sounds like while there are things that you would use to reply to that, what's encouraging and discouraging, it almost feels like there's an opportunity here for me. That's kind of my takeaway is that, to
Yeah.
your point, folks within, the EPC in particular, but I guess other denominations as well, aren't as politically motivated or vested. And the way that they show up, if they do, doesn't seem super significant. I mean, I use that very loosely. And so if that's the case, we have an opportunity to right size what's happening in our immediate context, and even like look outside ourselves. I mean, you brought up information about believers as they've grown in Iran. So with that, like, would you have an idea or ways that you've seen the ability to capture these opportunities? Maybe one of it being like, hey, literally look beyond the United States to see what God is doing to expand his kingdom elsewhere. Maybe that's a tactic. Maybe it's, so I don't know if you've got other suggestions for our leaders and congregations to maximize this opportunity that we have.
Yeah, I think a few things. The first is helping your congregation get straight what politics actually is. In Truth Over Tribe, I have a quote from a professor named Lee Camp. And I think his definition of what a politic is helpful because when we hear a politic, we think about a partisan identity. So if I say, what's your politics? I'm going to say I'm a Republican or I'm a Democrat. And this is what Lee Camp says. He says, a politic is an all-encompassing manner of communal life that grapples with all the questions the classical arts of politics has always asked. How do we live together? How do we deal with offenses? How do we deal with money? How do we deal with enemies and violence? How do we arrange marriage and families and social structures? How is authority mediated? How is it employed and ordered? How do we rightfully order passions and appetites? And much more besides, but especially these. Where is human history headed? What does it mean to be human? And what does it look like to live in a rightly ordered human community that engenders flourishing justice and the peace of God? That is a politic. And what is not a politic is the horse race happening in Washington, D.C. In Charles Dickens' novel Bleak House, there's this character named Mrs. Jellyby, and she's got all these children living in her house that she ignores and treats terribly. But she loves sending money off to this orphanage in Africa. And she loves hearing about the orphanage. She loves reading about the orphanage. She loves those children in the orphanage. And Charles Dickens is making an ironic point. Her attention is so telescoped to what's happening in Africa that she can't see what's happening right in front of her. This is exactly the problem we have to address in our churches. Our congregation has virtually no impact on what will happen in Washington, D.C., unless you're living in Washington, D.C., in which case, different conversation. That's not most people, okay? You have virtually no impact on that. You know what you do have an impact on? You have an impact on the local politic, how we treat our enemies, how we bring about flourishing, justice, and wholeness in our community. What we need to do is tell people, I don't care who you vote for, not because it's unimportant, because it's the least important thing you will do politically this year. The most important thing you will do politically this year is how you treat your neighbor and how you build institutions locally, how you pursue the arts, how you pursue justice, how you build businesses and charities and education. That is a politic. Give them a vision to say, you think that politics out there, God's got this amazing political thing for you to do. And then help them see this, that when Jesus gets on top of the mountain like Moses and begins to give his 10 commandments called the, Sermon on the Mount, that is Jesus's politic. He's already told us how to live our life together. He's given us the answer to those questions, and that needs to guide our politic as a church. And again, that's the key point when that aha goes like, oh my gosh, that's what Paul means when he calls himself a citizen of heaven. He's not saying, I can't wait to go die and be with God. He's saying, I have a passport here. It's called heaven. That's my kingdom. When I go into the church, we have a politic. We have a way of doing things here that's totally different than the rest of the world. But if we do it, we bless the community around us. And if our churches become famous for being oriented towards the poor and the needy and doing good deeds, that's how you're going to get your people to start focusing. You say, what can you do? So, like, one thing we started doing as a congregation is once a year, sometimes twice a year, we do big fundraisers for external organizations that are doing fantastic things in our community as a way of just being generous and giving. So, one year, for example, we partnered with a group called RIP Medical Debt to raise funds to cancel medical debt for those individuals who were under the poverty line in our state. And we hope to raise enough money to just cancel all the medical debt in our city. The crazy thing of this program is you pay a cent and they can pay off a dollar of medical debt. It's so unlikely to be paid off, the bank will take a cent instead of a dollar. They're like, anything's better than nothing. And so we thought, okay, we're going to try to pay off the debt in our city. Well, our church gave so generously that we were able to pay off through that system a total of $43 million. It was something like 30 counties in our state. That's a politic. Now, again, money's not everything, generosity and everything, but that's a way of being in the world. We got phone calls from people and they're saying, I don't, I'm gay and I've never been to a church. Why in the world did you do this for me? And our response to them was, well, you know what? Here's the deal. I don't know why in the world Jesus did what he did for me, but I was a debtor to him and he set me free. That's the answer they need to, and they're like, okay, this is a wild politic, but Something weird's happening there. And we just try to do that year after year. So that's just one example. Again, you can do the exact same thing in terms of how you're partnering with local charities and organizations. But that, again, that's one small dimension of practicing a politic as a community. So when people come in like, most of your church is voting for Trump, you're like, I don't care. Look at these people who've been housed because of us. Look at these single moms who are cared for every week because of us. Look at these people who are in this food pantry who have food every week because of us, because we have volunteers there, because we have people who are loving them, because we have people who are giving. That's something that's hard to argue with. And you say, so I don't really care about federal politics. I want to follow the principle of subsidiarity and say what's happening in front of me is key and critical. Giving up people a very clear and very clear calling of what they're called to do is key. Our second book, I've got a copy right here, Joyful Outsiders. That's exactly why we wrote this book. It really is the follow-up to Truth Over Tribe, because in it we lay out six different roles or paradigms of how everyday Christians can engage the world around them. So we're trying to give people a sense of calling and vocation. Like, okay, I feel confused by my culture. What do I do next? And we say, well, based on your personality and your opportunities, maybe one of these six ways is going to connect with you personally. And you don't have to do them all because we're a body, right? But you got to find a way for you to be active. And what I've discovered is that when people start getting active in their communities, it just decentralizes their attention from being fixated and telescoped to what's happening in Washington, D.C. I suspect that people who spend tons of time watching cable news, listening to, in fact, I remember reading a study about this, that the amount you listen to cable news and like political podcasts was actually negatively related to how politically active you were in your community, like in terms of like your like service and caring. That's pretty interesting, isn't it? So let's get people caring and serving and building institutions and businesses and education. Like let's get in those places and see if we can change those places locally, because we actually have power and influence in those spaces.
Amen. It's a little bit of a broader vision and much more biblically grounded than just passing out a voter guide or something like that in the church. Thank you for that, Patrick. That was just, it's so inspiring to hear real world examples, real life examples of churches that are doing this well. I'm glad you brought up the new book because I was just about to ask you about it. We up to this point we were mainly talking about Truth Over Tribe, but you've got Joyful Outsiders coming out. By the way, when does that hit the bookshelves? Is that in January?
Yeah, the book publishes in January. Publisher sends you
Okay.
the copies. That's where I got this thing from.
So Patrick was kind enough to give a little sneak peek, and he'll tell you more about that later because you're going to have an opportunity for that sneak peek as well. But in the book, in Joyful Outsiders, you suggest that one major problem that we face in the church is kind of a one size fits all approach to politics and cultural engagement. Why do you think it's important for us to develop, a more diverse approach to engaging in our culture?
I think that's a fantastic question. Let me start here. I want to tell a story. I'm gonna pull something up on here, see if I can find it. There it is. So this is, man, 5 or 6 years ago. Actually, no, gosh, we're getting almost 10 years ago, 2015. It's funny how time flies by. 2020 is like a time warp. Anytime that goes in of it and out of it, it's just lost. In 2015, there was a coach named Joe Kennedy who was coaching football in a city just outside of Seattle, a very de-churched, unchurched region. The majority of people there wouldn't have been Christians, probably under 10%, very similar to Columbia, where I live. And at the end of every football game, for about 10 years before that, he would go to the center of the football field, take a knee, and pray. Didn't pressure any students to come with him, didn't necessarily really invite anyone, but sometimes students would go out and pray alongside him. It would be a silent prayer, 30 seconds, that's all. And then in 2015, the superintendent, a guy named Aaron Laval, became very concerned because he was getting questions about this and whether this violated some laws around prayer inside of schools and school events. And so he wrote a cease and desist letter essentially to Joe Kennedy, the coach, and said, hey, you need to stop praying. Well, Joe Kennedy refused. And he kept going back out onto the field. And week after week, he did this. And it begins to become a public spectacle to the point where, after several weeks, you've got people going out on the field, huge amounts from both sides to pray with him. And then other people rushing the field, bowling over the marching team, so much that an assistant coach said he thought he was going to be shot. That's how violent this got, trying to protest what was happening. And so finally, Aaron LaVall writes to Joe Kennedy and says, hey, you're going to be put on a leave of absence. You can no longer be a coach in our schools. And so Joe Kennedy, he spends several years in a Supreme Court battle. He actually ends up winning the Supreme Court battle over this. But that's really not the key of the story. There's one part of the story that no one ever tells. Joe Kennedy and Aaron LaVall went to the same church. Now, I don't know how that works, right? going to the bathroom and, oh, yeah, you're the guy who kicked me out of my job, or you're the guy who won't stop praying on field. And the crazy part is, you can make a biblical and historical case for each position. Right, let's start with Joe Kennedy, right? The guy who was on the field praying. He could say, look, Jesus was clear. If you deny me in the presence of other people, I will deny you before the Father. I wasn't out there trying to do a protest, but I'm not going to deny my faith in public. I'm going to pray and I'm going to announce him as Lord. And what you're doing is calling me to deny him. But you can imagine Aaron LaVall responding and saying, well, hold on, didn't Jesus also say that when you pray, you should pray in a closet and not out in public like the hypocrites do? And you might say, weren't there people in history like the SBC who applauded the Supreme Court when it came out with a finding saying that prayer was banned in schools? But that's also true. There's a long history of nonconformists in America saying we don't want prayer in schools. So I'm not sure you're so right. And I think this highlights a problem that we have. We have churches that tend to emphasize one way of engaging the world and leave out another. We either want to be a church that cultivates the world and says, we're the Aaron LaVals. We're inside the institutions. We're trying to make the world a better place. We love talking about Jeremiah 29, build houses and vineyards and give your sons and daughters in marriage and the welfare of the city, you'll find your welfare. And that's true. But Jeremiah also wrote Jeremiah 50 to 54, where he says, Babylon will burn. And he says, don't fall down before Baal. He says, keep your luggage close to you because the day is coming and you don't want to get caught in the conflagration. He's saying, look, this place, Babylon, it's an airport. It's an in-between place. You're not in your home, but you're not where you're going. So don't fall in love with the glossy magazines and the cruddy pizza. Jeremiah has both pictures, doesn't he? He's got cultivation and he's got resistance. And I think he wants us to hold these things as a tension. Now, when I say tension, everybody thinks, I don't know if I've got anything in here I can even show this with. Here, I'll do it with my mouse. Here we go. Look, every time someone says like tension, sometimes what we think is like, you want me to be in the middle. Like, I'm just gonna think I'm gonna be like halfway cultivate, halfway resist. Well, watch. If I put my hands halfway, what happens? There's no tension, right? And then what you get is like, some people say, well, I just wanna cultivate, no tension. I just wanna resist, no tension. The only way to get tension is to pull hard in both directions. We as churches need to learn how to both cultivate and resist hard at the same time. That's the challenge that's standing before us. And that requires a diversity of ways of engaging the world. Let me just do this little thing. This is a little mind test I like to do. And everybody in your own heads, you can answer this question. I want you for a second to list out three Christians who have had a significant impact on their culture. Okay. You can think about who they are for just a second. So I'll tell you mine. I'd have Dietrich Bonhoeffer. If you don't know who he is, he's a guy who lived during the rise of Nazism and founded an underground seminary to resist Nazism, and was a part of a failed assassination attempt against Hitler and later died in a concentration camp. My second one would be Martin Luther King. I think everybody knows who he is. He led the nonviolent civil rights movement. And he emphasized that nonviolence was the core of an effective and Christian protest. He said, if we want to create a community of nonviolence, we have to be nonviolent ourselves. My third one, probably Saint Teresa of Calcutta, who founded hundreds of orphanages in India, hospices, leper houses, those sorts of things. And she emphasized that the care of the poor was a key way to change the world. Now, I want you to imagine putting them in the room and saying, hey, you three people, tell me how you should change the world. How should we faithfully represent Jesus? And how should we, represent him in a hostile culture? And you can imagine Bonhoeffer being the first one to respond. I'm just going to read this quote. This is a quote from Bonhoeffer. And he might say, we are not simply to bandage the wounds of victims beneath the wheels of injustice. We are to drive a spoke into the wheel itself. We can imagine Dr. King responding, well, we adopt the means of nonviolence because our end is a community at peace with itself. Or you can imagine Saint Teresa coming along saying, well, if you want to bring peace to the whole world, this is a quote, then go home, love your family, your neighbor, the poor, and the unborn. And so I love to ask the question, like, which one of these three is correct? who's right in this situation? We need all three. And it happens in the Bible as well, right? I mean, consider people like Daniel and Esther and Nehemiah, right? If someone asked them, hey, how should you respond to your enemies? Daniel might say, hey, I didn't fight my enemies and I allowed them to, you know, make me into a dessert for lions, a feast for lions. And Esther might respond, well, I actually threw a feast to destroy my enemies. And Nehemiah might respond, hey, I built a wall to keep the people of Samaria out. And Jesus might even come along and say, well, I actually spilled my blood to tear the wall down between Jews and Samaritans. We have this amazing diversity of responses inside the Bible, and we need them all in our churches. The problem is, we as churches, we want cultivator, we want resist. We want one voice, but we don't want all the voices of Scripture. We can't sing the song of Jesus with one voice without harmony. We have to have all of the pieces and parts. And so I think that's one of the challenges that we're facing right now is not becoming the social justice church or the arts church or the leadership entrepreneurship church or the, we can become all these different kind, you know, the spiritual discipline church, the evangelism church. We need all of those in one church. And that's how we actually change the world.
That's great. You know, as you're sharing, there are a few dynamics about, I think, just humans in general, not just specific to us Americans. But, you know, I even think about things like stereotypes in that it doesn't require a lot of effort or rigor or thinking, really. It's easier just to lean on things that are two-dimensional, one-dimensional stereotypes. And so what you're describing, whether with, you know, the mouse cord and the idea of attention, and your book mentions six different ways that we can engage culture, is that there needs to be a certain posture from believers or just people in general, but certainly believers that anticipate the need for that level of rigor, right? To have a nuanced approach. Nuance is hard. And so then what you said earlier about 2020, 2019, what happened not just in the States, but globally, I mean, that really sucked out so much of whatever bandwidth we thought that we had. And so I think in some ways the cards are stacked against us, right? It's easy just to be polarized, another term that we used earlier. So I think there's a challenge. And I don't know, from my end, it's almost like, you know, what Paul says, what he encourages us to do in that just don't walk by the flesh. But walk and live by the Spirit. And I think that, to your point, of all believers, past, present, and even the future, can engage in certain ways. And, you know, they can all be God's way. But I think the game changer really is like, what is or how is the Spirit at work, and how can we partner with the Spirit? So anyway, just some thoughts and, you know, looking forward to your book coming out and unpacking a little bit more about what those six ways happen to be. Shifting gears just a little bit, I'm curious to know, and you mentioned a few dynamics as it relates to things like media, whether print media, TV, podcasts, social media. In what ways in this era of just humanity in general, with the plethora of, you know, tech and media and consumption, like, how do you think that plays a role in how we engage politics in general? I mean, that's a huge kind of question, but what kinds of observations have you seen, maybe even studies, as to how media slash technology plays a role in all of this?
Yeah, I remember several years ago, I had a husband and wife come into my office and they were clearly hurting. She's upset, she's crying. And she came in and she's there because she lost her mom. And she made it clear, though, she didn't lose her mom like her mom died. She lost her mom to Facebook. Several years earlier, her mom just wanted to see pictures of her grandkids. And so they're like, hey, hop onto Facebook. We got pictures of the grandkids on there. You can stay up to date, see what's happening. So she gets on there, she's looking at her grandkids. But slowly, over a process of years, she started seeing other things on Facebook. And being an older woman, I think lacked some of the requisite media literacy to understand, hey, what's real, what's not real, what's true, what's not true. But as time went on, she got sucked down some of these conspiracy rabbit trails. And this became more and more evident to her daughter because she began to post some pretty radical things on her own Facebook page. And when they'd see her, she'd notice that her whole demeanor, I mean, her face, she was sullen, she was frustrated, she was angry. She said, My mom was one of the most joyful people I'd ever met. And my mom, when bullies used to, shove me and, pick on me, she would always tell me what Jesus said, to turn the other cheek and to love my enemies. And now I'm watching my mom talking about the need to bomb our enemies, destroy people, and show hatred towards people that we don't like. And it was so disorienting. That's what she meant, was that I lost my mom to Facebook, because try her best, she couldn't get her mom out of that conspiracy theory hole that social media algorithms had created. And statistically speaking, you're actually not very likely to pull anyone out of that hole. Once someone goes down that path, unfortunately, you are very, very, very lucky if you see a change. And you won't see change, by the way, by just trying to give them truth. Relationships about the only way to change people. That's neither here nor there. The point is, her mom got there because the Facebook and all of these algorithms, Instagram, TikTok, they are designed to keep you on their platforms. And these AIs were developed to figure out what kept your attention. And very quickly, they realized the things that hold our attention are things that cause outrage, anger, frustration, lust. I mean, these are the things any of us could have guessed. And so they began to put material in front of people in order to keep them on this platform, much of which was not true. In fact, the MIT Technology Review found that 19 of the top 20 Christian Facebook pages are run by foreign troll farms. These are foreign national agents who are trying to disrupt this democracy by targeting what they see as a vulnerable demographic. And if you go to these pages, 90% of it looks just like down the pipe evangelical, rainbows with, Chuck Swindoll quotes. However, there's about 5 to 10% that is very dangerous, very misleading, and is intentionally designed and created by people to deceive and to make people mistrust one another. There is no doubt that since the advent of the internet in 2000, and then advent of social media being widespread in 2010, is when smartphones start getting its Instagram comes out. Our social trust is in rapid, rapid, rapid decline. Our ability to trust doctors, to trust politicians, trust pastors, to trust educators, to trust virtually every institution owner, every person represented, it is dramatically decreased. And this is not a mistake. In the CEO of Instagram said that he wants influencers to replace our institutions. This is by design. TikTok recently released, or it was recently leaked, that they realized that they designed their algorithm to addict teenagers to it within 30 minutes. What we have to understand is that we have a reality distortion machine. I mean, we can go into a whole different talk about how AI and generative AI is able to create false images and now false videos that I promise you cannot tell if they're real, which is terrifying, right? Not just because there'll be fake stuff, but because there'll be real stuff people say that's AI. To get themselves out of it. But pressing beyond that, there's a disinformation machine, and it's on both sides. The New York Times just reported about what's happening over on the left. The Harris-Wallace administration, just as much as the Trump-Vance administration, they are pumping out false information knowingly. And again, these platforms are designed to carry it forward. But what we often don't understand is that there's the reality distortion machine, what I like to call the false prophet. And I'm not dispensational, that's not where I'm going, but I am saying that Revelation gives us a picture of what we can expect in every age of the church. And there is a false prophet that is out there spewing the lies of the beast, deceiving people to bow down before it. But there is still a beast, and that's the reality domination machine. The thing that most people don't realize is that we had the most robust antitrust laws in human history. These are laws that protect us against monopolies. We have those in part because British parliamentarians in the 17th century, they were the first people in human history since the advent of monopolies to take the power of monopoly from a monarch. They removed it, then they removed his head afterwards, because that's how they ruled back in the 1600s. And they did that because they understood that monopolies are a mechanism of domination by discrimination. In other words, if you have a monopoly, you are able to discriminate. You can choose who pays what price, who gets what goods. This shouldn't shock us, because do you know who invented monopolies? Tiberius Caesar, the Roman emperor who was in charge at the time of Jesus. And actually, when you read Revelation 18, it describes the beast as this economic machine. It actually doesn't focus on Rome's military might. The items that list that the beasts are selling are many of the items that Tiberius granted monopolies in to nobles in order to consolidate power and to dominate by discrimination. We are now living in an era where we have torn down most of our antitrust laws. We've now said that monopolies are anti-consumer, not anti-freedom. So if you can prove that it's not bad for a consumer, you can monopolize whatever you want to. This is why Google and Meta, they are all in court right now. And unfortunately, we have no political will to stop what they're doing. And the reason why they're in court is because they are dominating our media ecosystem in such a way that they are quite literally able to choose which businesses fail and which businesses succeed, which politicians fail and which politicians succeed, what you see and what you don't see. They record where you walk. They know what's in your email. They know who you're texting. They know who you're marrying. If you're having an affair, they know who you're having an affair with. They know every detail about us. They have detailed models of every individual out there. And we like to think we're adults who can't be controlled. And I know it looks like I've got a foil hat right on. I swear, I do not, right? What we have to deal with is that the political milieu we're in, the lack of trust that we have, the amount of anger and anxiety that's in the system, this is fantastic for the monopolists who can control and take hold of that anger, that frustration, and that anxiety, and then capitalize it, turn it into financial gain for themselves. And there is no one, not the American government, anyone who's able to stop them. Like I said, I know I sound like a wacko person. I promise I'm not. You can find this stuff. It's all in public. I mean, just one fun little fact. He's, oh, what about journalists? And, you know, I get my information from reliable news sources, like, you know, New York Times, you know, august journalistic institution. Google paid the New York Times $100 million last year to make the New York Times its preferred news dealer. That sounds backwards. If I was New York Times, I might pay Google $100 million to make me its preferred news provider. Why would Google do that? Because Google is paying off virtually every major news organization, and those that are trying to stand against Google for taking away their revenue unfairly, it is essentially choosing, you don't get to speak. That is terrifying. And so we can talk, we've been here talking about politics, and I think it's incredibly important. I think the far more terrifying world that we need to deal with is the Google, Meta, Microsoft, Amazon system that is very much so in control of how we communicate. And because we are a species that thinks with words, they aren't just in control of how we communicate, they're in control of how we think. And that is a terrifying place to be and something that Christians should be deeply concerned about. I'm not a Luddite. I'm not saying you need to get off the internet and social media, but we need to be incredibly sober about what we are experiencing online.
Patrick, I know that you, I mean, this is definitely your area of expertise or one of your areas of expertise. What are some resources that you would recommend to our people, to our pastors and ruling elders as they're, you know, seeking to disciple their congregations well? And I agree with you. I think that we give a lot of attention to, you know, our engagement in red or blue, you know, Democrat or Republican. But the role of media and technology can be a huge blind spot for us. So what are some resources you would highlight for us?
Yeah, I mean, I think this is an area where we don't have enough resources yet. If you go to endeavorwithus.com, I've got a little newsletter where I'm writing about some of these topics. That's a place you can go. The Gospel Coalition is releasing a book sometime next year called Scrolling Ourselves to Death. That's reflecting on the work of Neil Postman. I contributed a chapter to that. It's a fantastic book. It'd be a great place to go and explore some of these themes, even from a pastoral perspective. I think moving beyond that, one of the best things we can do, because you're not going to get on stage and do what I just did and, you know, talk about false prophets and beasts and the horror of Babylon. I mean, maybe if you are going through Revelation, you could talk about big tech. But I don't know how helpful.
I mean, I don't know. Halloween's next week. Sounds like some opportunity for some costume play.
I should have come here in that costume, wearing my beast. So, you know, what I would say is I want to put a pebble in people's shoe. I might not be able to convince you that your favorite news commentator is not always a reliable person. And by the way, they might actually be a reliable, you know, individuals are different from the machine. But what I do want to do is put a pebble in your shoe where you start at least feeling uncomfortable. Like you start asking the question, can I trust everything that I'm seeing here? Can I trust everything that I'm reading here? And I think you don't do that by doing what I just did. I think you do it by giving stories and examples, true examples of how there's been misleading news that deceives people. And there's countless examples. You can find them all over the place. You show examples of AI, you know, generative AI. Like, look at these crazy things people create, and just remind people, hey, we are a people of the truth. And so when you get to those passages, if you're preaching through the Bible and it's talking about truth or it's talking about deception or falsehood, I think those are the points at which we can actually begin to lean in and say, hey, where we in our culture are being misled is not just by the deceptive philosophies of our time. It's actually by these literally computer controlled systems that are designed to captivate us by misleading us and help people to go, oh, I never thought that. I never saw that before. That's really good. And so I think those are the practical places we can start. Of course, if you have people who are really committed, you can point them for some of the books and resources that I've already mentioned. But I think the average person is not that interested in media ecology. So it's more sort of saying you just want to get them thinking like, yeah, maybe this isn't something I want to trust and invest a lot of time in. Last thought, encourage long form reading in your congregation. That's just one of the most important things you can do. And the way you do that, by the way, is just talking about the things that you read, not to impress people. But I think when people have pastors that are readers, that sets an expectation of, oh, like this might actually be part of my discipleship as well. Giving people book recommendations. So, you know, obviously you've got books that are long form, but also, you know, magazines or long form essays, even online, like those are really good. And if you've got people who can't do those, you know, or like audiobooks, like even long form podcasts, something that keeps them focused on a topic long enough that's not this constant dividing up of attention on social media. I'm swiping, 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 another thing, another thing, another thing. I'm watching news media and the ticker's rolling, 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 rolling. Like we have to just pull back and help people begin to learn how to focus on one thing at a time again. And it's amazing. Like once people like reclaim their ability to focus, their life's more enjoyable. And they are honestly much less easily deceived by the machine that's around them.
That's great. Thank you for those resource recommendations and even that practical application of long form reading. Kind of starting to turn a corner here towards the finish line, but we're about 2 weeks out from Election Day. And there are probably a good number of people who have already cast their ballots. So just kind of like looking at these last few weeks, or these next few weeks, sorry. What would you want to leave as food for thought for those that have yet to cast ballots? But then after, you know, November 5th, regardless of what happens and as the dust begins to settle, and hopefully it settles quickly, you know, what kinds of truths or what of God's truths should we consider moving forward and beyond?
Yeah. I think it's a great question. You know, we like to talk a lot about what our, well, what this group is called, our identity in Christ. And when we talk about our identity in Christ, you know, we'll talk about us being, you know, children of God, adopted by God. We'll talk about union with Christ, being in Christ. These are really common, beautiful ways of describing what our identity is, who we are in Jesus. But the Bible actually has another category that I don't think we spend enough time talking about. There hasn't been enough theological work around it, in my opinion. And it goes from Old Testament all the way to New Testament. And it's the Bible uses different language for this identity, but it sounds like this. You are a sojourner. You are a foreigner. You are an exile. You are an outsider. You know, it depends on your translation. You're going to get different pieces and parts, but it's undeniable that this language, I mean, the old credo in the Old Testament that the Hebrews would say to one another was that my father was a wandering Aramean. That was the picture that they had of Jacob. And they're saying, look, this is the reality of my life. I don't belong here. This is not my home. And of course, the earth is our ultimate home in the resurrection, but you understand point. In his letter to Roman citizens living in modern day Turkey, Peter, in the very first verse of his first letter, says to the elect, to the chosen, exiles living in Cappadocia, goes on and on and on, right? I love to think about that Roman woman, whoever she was, sitting in there saying, wait a second, my husband's a citizen of Rome. I lived here my whole life. What do you mean exile? You're just talking to the Jews in the room? We're not exiles. No, you are an exile here. You are an outsider here. And when you get to the book of Hebrews, it's not a book people go to and they think about engaging our culture, but I think it's a book we really need when we start thinking about engaging our culture. Because in the book of Hebrews, in Hebrews 12, it tells us something really important. It says that Jesus chose the cross, right? It says that he chose the cross, Hebrews 12, for the joy that was set before him. He understood that he was going to choose to be an outsider, cast outside the city, exiled outside the city, exiled by his own people, exiled by creation, exiled by the whole of all, right? He said he chose to do that and to bear the shame of the cross. Why? According to Hebrews 12, for the joy that was set before him. He saw that choosing to be an outsider was choosing to be joyful. These were not two different things. And then we go to Hebrews 13, and he's continuing on this exact same thought. And in Hebrews 13, I think it's around verse 12, the author commands him, he says, now you therefore go outside the gate where he is and bear the shame that he bore. So it's this beautiful picture of Jesus outside the city gate. And he says, now you guys go be outsiders too. Get outside the city and go to that place where he died and go be with him. And he says, for we do not have an enduring city here, but we have an eternal city to come. He's saying, yes, you don't belong here. You have an eternal city that's to come. And that's the joy that you're looking forward to. The joy of being an outsider, as you're putting in that vote, like what I'm trying to do is say, like, give it away. Like, loose-handedly, this is not my home. That doesn't mean I don't care about it. It doesn't mean I don't work for it. But this is not my home. I am an outsider here. And I'm going to choose to be an outsider. I don't care who wins this election at the end of the day, because it will not change who's on the throne of heaven. Years ago, this is the 1800s. There's a tightrope walker. His name was Charles Blondin, most famous tightrope walker in the world. And his greatest feat that he was ever going to attempt was crossing the Niagara Falls on a tightrope. It had never been accomplished before. And so he goes out there. There's crowds and crowds of people. And there's still newspaper reports. And they're asking people, what do you think will happen? And everybody's saying, oh, he's going to fall. He's going to die. Anybody this stupid, this idiotic deserves to die. Americans were fun back then. And that's why they're there, by the way. They want to watch this guy fall into the Niagara Falls. I mean, that's what everybody assumes is going to happen. So he starts going across the tightrope. And he's a little bit wobbly. And he gets about halfway across. And he finally sits down on the tightrope. And people think, well, this is it. He's going to give up. And in fact, he lowers a rope down to a boat that was in the falls below him. And people are watching. All of a sudden, they notice he's bringing the rope back up. And when he brings it back up, he has something attached to it. And he opens it up. And they realize all of a sudden it's a bottle of wine. He downs the bottle of wine. He gets back up on the rope and he gets all the way across. And of course, the crowd goes wild. Then after this, he does his crazy feats. He goes across it backwards. He goes across it blindfolded. He goes without his balance beam. He takes a camera, one of those old 1800 cameras, halfway across. He takes a picture of the crowd. And he gets across and he comes back one day after about 2 weeks to this. And he says, do you believe that I can do anything on this rope? And they go, oh, yes, of course. We believe it. We believe it. He says, great. One of you volunteer to get on my back. And the crowd goes silent, except for one man, a guy named Harry Calcourt. He raises his hand and he climbs onto Charles Blondin's back. And as they get about halfway across, the guy wires holding the rope begin to snap because there's too much weight on the rope. And they're wobbling. And Charles Blondin says to Harry Calcourt on his back, he says, Harry, you don't try to balance. Harry, we are one. When I lean, you lean. When I sway, you sway. Do not try to balance. Whatever I do, move with me. We are one. And if we are not one, we will perish. They slowly but surely make their way to the other side of the rope. When Jesus invites us to come and be an outsider with him, he's saying, you've seen me walk the tightrope. I've gone through death and come out the other side alive. Now, who wants to get on my back? Now, the catch here is, it's scary to be an outsider. Joy is not the same thing as being happy all the time. Paul says, I am suffering yet always rejoicing in 2 Corinthians. But the only person who experiences the tension and the hardship of being an outsider is the one who raises their hand and says, Jesus, I want to be on your back. And when we get onto his back, it is scary walking across the Niagara, but it doesn't matter how good you are at tightrope walking. It only matters how good he is at tightrope walking. And then when it gets scary, he looks at you and he says, when I sway, you sway. When I lean, you lean. We are not different. We are one. And if we're not one, we perish. That's the promise of being an outsider in this world. That's the promise that we can take hold of that allows us to say, you know what? I care about the political process and I'm going to vote for the person who I think is the best candidate. I will take my civic responsibility as seriously as I can, but my citizenship is in heaven. I'm an outsider in this world. And great, I have the right and the ability to vote as an outsider. That's wonderful. Other people don't have that as outsiders in other places. But at the end of the day, I want Jesus. I want the joy of being with him. I want the joy of being on his back and doing all of life with him. That's what I want. And I think if that's our heart, if that's our posture, we are going to feel so much freedom during this entire election process. Freedom in the ballot booth, freedom in the weeks after as we wait for election results, freedom going forward to be the sort of people whose livelihoods aren't wavering depending on who's getting into the Oval Office, but are instead set firmly on the solid rock of Christ, his death, and his resurrection.
Amen. That's a good sermon right there. Patrick, I want to make sure that we give you a chance to mention the new book again and tell us a little bit about the special offer that we have from Zondervan tonight.
Yeah. So I reached out to the publisher and I said, hey, I want to be able to give people from the EPC something from the book. And so we have a PDF that I think we're going to email out after this of the third chapter of the book, which is called Naming the Tension. And when I was talking about the idea of being on a tightrope, it's really helpful if you're on the tightrope to understand why we feel the tension that we feel right now in our current cultural moment. I think it's actually really pastoral because things feel different now culturally than they did 15 years ago. It feels different to be a Christian now than it did just 10 years ago. So we need to begin to understand that. So it's back all the way back when we're talking about like analysis and like understanding what's our cultural moment. It does that work, but I think it does it in a way that's going to surprise readers because it helps us understand that even though we do live in a difficult time, this is nothing new for Christians. And so we've got that third chapter sitting in there. We've also got a little QR code at the back of it. So if it's something you want to get more of or something you want to get for your church, I asked Zondervan if they could give us a special discount for the EPC, and they're giving a 40% bulk discount. So if this is something that you really like, and you're like, gosh, I want to do this with my church, or even if you're like, hey, I want to read more of it to see if I want to do this for my church come in January, like just reach out and I'm happy to figure out how to get you a copy of the book specifically. But if you want to have that bulk discount of 40%, there's a QR code. You can use that. And again, this will hopefully equip people with those six different ways. There's actually an assessment in the book where people can figure out which of these six ways am I. A little personality-ish, if you will. But that's our hope. Like, we want people to walk out of this book feeling, I can be an outsider. I can be full of joy. I won't be combative. I won't be conformed. I won't be conflict avoidant. But instead, I'll have a clear sense of my calling and my vocation and my world. That's what I want for everyday Christians to have every day of their lives.
That's fantastic. Thank you so much for making that available for us. And sounds like a great resource for a session book study together or a small group study. So I hope folks snap it up. I'm going to drop in the chat just a link for people to register for our next webinar in the series that's coming up on November 18th. And as I do, just a reminder, if you're watching tonight and you have a burning question that you'd like to ask Patrick before we say goodnight, be sure to drop it into the Q&A toward the middle of your middle bottom of your Zoom screen, I should say. Feel free to drop a question in there. Here is the link if you want to register for our upcoming November 18th webinar. And I will definitely be emailing out tonight the PDF that Patrick shared of chapter 3 of the new book. And again, it also includes that 40% off code if you want to do a bulk order for your small group or your session. So feel free to take advantage of that. I think it's going to be a great resource for the church. Dan, I'm looking at your eyes. I'm gonna let you take the next word from here.
Thank you. I am just checking our chat function Q&A. All right, I think we're good. So I guess just wanted to say thank you again to Patrick for sharing from some very personal places in your own journey as you've been leading your own congregation or helping in that setting, and then just being a blessing to the EPC in this way. So thank you also, Annie, for everyone who's joined. With that, if you wouldn't mind, I can just close us in a time of prayer. How about that? Let's pray. Well, God, thank you for this opportunity. God, just a lot of great reminders and insights from Patrick. So, Lord, thank you for how you've been at work in his life and his desire to do his best to be a faithful child of God, a faithful son of God, in the midst of his current context. And Lord, his context isn't entirely unique to him, particularly when we think about just being citizens of this country, this time of year, this time of cycle, God, where we are about to elect a new leader for our country. But God, thank you again for his work, his contributions, and his reminders to really lean into you, Jesus. So, Father, even today, as we've talked about, there are just a lot of people who are exhausted. We find ourselves exhausted. Some of that exhaustion being from the kinds of conversations around engaging politics, engaging our culture in one way or another. And so, Father, I'm just reminded of the words that your son Jesus said about those who are weary. So, Lord, would we, Jesus, come to you? And rather than trying to always be on the defensive or to respond or to even make happy or please other people, Jesus, if we would only take on your yoke because it is light, it is easy. And so, Lord, may we be faithful as followers of you. And God, even this truth that we see throughout scripture that your people really on this side of eternity are sojourners, are foreigners, are living in a form of exile, to be on the outside until you redeem all things, Jesus. And so it is our prayer that we would be faithful to you. God bless us. We ask for your blessing. We ask for your leadership, both on ourselves and our congregations, that how we show up matters, not just what or who we believe, but how we show up, how we live for you. And God, we pray that in all of these things, that truly you would be glorified and that it would be your kingdom being expanded first in our own hearts and then in the world around us. So, Lord, we thank you for this time. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So good to be together, Patrick. Again, thank you so much. Really appreciate your ministry.
Thank you for having me. This is great.
All right. Good night, all.